My name is Katie Del May, and I am the curator of the exhibition we are, of course, celebrating, Carrie Mae Weems, 3 Decades of Photography and Video, which opened to the public just yesterday. This long overdue retrospective, comprised of over 200 photographs, videos, and text pieces from more than 25 different series, provides the first opportunity on a large scale to trace the evolution of Weems' career over the last 30 years. From her earliest black and white documentary photos of the mid-1970s to the increasingly layered and complex images that often experiment with material and process of more recent times. Throughout all of the works, Weems addresses issues surrounding equality and power, especially as it relates to gender, race, and class. She also inserts marginalized peoples and hidden histories into the historical record, not only to bring forgotten experiences to light, but to provide a more multidimensional picture of humanity as a whole. As the artist will probably explain further in a moment, it is important to know that while the subjects of her works are often African Americans, Weems wants people of color to stand for the human multitudes, and for her art to resonate with audiences of all backgrounds. In conjunction with the opening of this show, we are pleased to be offering 3 special programs today. Of course, the keynote address by the artist herself, a panel discussion with her and the esteemed contributors to the accompanying catalog later this afternoon at 1 o'clock, and a performative response to Weems' work in the galleries, a new program for us, at 3:30 by dancer Kyle Abraham. Before we begin, though, I'd like to quickly express our thanks to Southwest Airlines and the Danner Foundation for their support of today's public programs. And if you haven't done so already, please stop by the registration area to enter to win 2 free tickets from Southwest Airlines. The exhibition, Carrie Mae Weems, 3 Decades of Photography and Video, is supported in part by platinum sponsor, the HCA Foundation, on behalf of the HCA and the TriStar family of hospitals, our hospitality sponsor, the Union Station Hotel, and design sponsor, Highbrow Furniture. The exhibition is also funded in part by grants from the Andy Warhol Foundation for the Visual Arts, the National Endowment for the Arts, and a gift from Robert and Richard Menschel. In addition, I wish to extend our thanks to the Metro Nashville Arts Commission and the Tennessee Arts Commission, which is supported in part by the National Endowments for the Arts, for their ongoing support of programs like these that we can offer to you for free. I've also been asked to remind you that boxed lunches will be available in the lobby. We don't want to inundate our cafe with too many folks, so feel free to take advantage of that opportunity after Carrie's lecture. Without further ado, let me say that I am deeply honored to have worked closely with Carrie Mae Weems over the last 4 years as we prepared for this exhibition, and now to have this opportunity to introduce her to you. She is, of course, an internationally acclaimed photographer. As an art critic at the New York Times declared recently, no American photographer of the last quarter century has turned out a more probing, varied, and moving body of work. Carrie Mae Weems was born and raised in Portland, Oregon. In his foreword to the catalog, Henry Louis Gates Jr. notes that perhaps this, quote, doubly unique experience to grow up black in a largely white environment and to grow up black in an environment unlike that experienced by most African Americans is what may have given Weems her strikingly original perspective. She left Portland in her late teens, becoming a modern dancer and grassroots political activist in the San Francisco Bay Area. In 1974, a friend gave her a camera for her 21st birthday, and she immediately saw its ability to give tangible form to the abstract social and political ideas that she was interested in, and its potential for inciting change. She first studied photography at the Studio Museum in Harlem before returning to California and receiving a BFA from the California Institute of the Arts in 1981 and an MFA from UC San Diego in 1984, and then studying folklore at the University of California, Berkeley from 1984 to 87. Since that time, Weems' work has been shown widely across the globe. She has had solo exhibitions at the Centro Andaluz de Arte Contemporáneo in Seville, Spain, The Rudenstein Gallery at the W.E.B. Du Bois Institute for African and African American Research at Harvard University, the Museum of Modern Art in New York, the Whitney Museum of American Art, the San Francisco Museum of Modern Art, the High Museum of Art, the Santa Barbara Museum of Art, the J. Paul Getty Museum, and on and on. She has been included in more prestigious group shows than I will attempt to begin to list, but I do just want to mention one, the show 30 Americans that's been traveling around the country and that will be here at the Frist Center next year at this time, so I hope you come back for a little more of Weems' work next year. Her works are also included in major museum collections, including the Museum of Modern Art, the Metropolitan Museum of Art, the Art Institute of Chicago, the Los Angeles County Museum of Art, the Whitney Museum, again, and the Portland Art Museum, as well as several others. Finally, she is the recipient of several important awards, most notably a Paula Krasner Foundation grant in photography in 2002, the Joseph H. Hazen Rome Prize Fellowship at the American Academy in Rome in 2005, and Anonymous Was a Woman Foundation Award in 2007. Please join me in warmly welcoming to the stage this very accomplished artist, Carrie Mae Weems.
I am so deeply honored, really, to be here. And of course, I have to say thank you to a few people. Oh my God, I don't even know where to start, really, because I look out in the audience and I'm seeing old friends. I'm seeing one of my professors from years ago when I was a student at CalArts. So deeply honored that he's here. Seeing Houston Baker, who illuminated a path for me to walk on. Seeing my great friend, Deborah Willis, who is not only an amazing historian, photographic historian, wonderful photographer, but my best friend. You know, Robert Storr, who gave me like one of my first, you know, significant exhibitions in New York, is here and contributed to the catalog. Franklin Sermon is here, who contributed to the catalog, who's been an amazing friend, you know, reminding me again and again and again and again and again that you do none of this by yourself, that you are always surrounded by people who are working with you, who are helping you, or who are assisting you on this sort of extraordinary journey. To, of course, you know, my amazing husband, Jeffrey Hoon, who is here, who has been my soul provider. You know, this wonderful man who is so humble and so brilliant and gentle in his way of dealing with me, because I'm absolutely crazy most of the time and difficult to deal with all of the time. And then, of course, I have to thank, you know, the Frist for inviting me here and giving me this amazing opportunity. This is a retrospective, and it's really quite amazing. It's absolutely overwhelming work, process, energy, effort on everybody's part. To the staff of the Frist, I send out 1,001 thanks. To the Frist family and Billy, who is here with, I think, his wife, Kate, who's going to party with us tonight, which I'm very much looking forward to. I'm looking forward to being very, very drunk at about midnight. And then there's this amazing young artist who taught me so much last night about essays on influence and style and vernacular and bending and shaping and the possibilities of what dance is and can be. I'm so grateful to Kyle Abraham. But mostly, of course, I'm really deeply indebted to Katie Delmey, who decided years ago and at some point to write her dissertation on my work. I'm always sort of amazed and humbled that anybody takes the time really to study my work, because I always think that there's somebody else that I'm interested in looking at. And so it's, but I'm deeply honored. But it takes an amazing amount of effort. It takes an amazing amount of focus. It takes an amazing amount of commitment to do a project like this. And so to Katie, I say thank you. People ask me where I come. Oh, wait, and then Miss Johnny. I have Miss Afro Chic in the house. Miss Afro Chic, John, who's back there with the blonde wig, hosting you all in today. Thank you for stepping into the landscape of imagination this morning. I appreciate it. I've been many places, and I've been lucky to go many places. But where I come from is probably the most important thing. And I come from this amazing family that has lots of people. We all started in Mississippi. My family started in Mississippi and then somehow made its way to the great Northwest, to Portland, Oregon, which is where I lived, where I grew up. And it continues to be perhaps the thing that influences me most. It's through my father's love of life and effort and storytelling and possibility and a sense of what was right that really places me and grounds me even still in my life. And then there are, of course, all the other artists that I'm constantly thinking about and I'm constantly trying to pay attention to. Old artists, new artists, dead artists, living artists, contemporary artists, classical artists, painters, other photographers, whether it be, you know, those of, you know, the works of Roy D. Caraba or people like Lou Draper or, you know, Robert Frank or Todd Papageorge or Edward Weston or Walker Evans, etc. Thinking about them a great deal. And for a long, long time, I got up very, very, very early in the morning and thought about other artists and looked at what other artists were doing. And every time I looked at what other artists were doing, it got me up. You know, that artists and what they do, their ability to live with themselves and their ability to try to attempt to negotiate this skin every morning, I think, is absolutely astounding. I have a great, great respect for what other artists do. And so I try to spend as much time with them as I possibly can. You know, there was a moment when I was, you know, fascinated with folklore and I studied folklore and then I decided that I was really interested in quilts and quilting. And at a certain point a few years ago, went down to G's Bend to just shake the hands of some of those extraordinary women who had made these amazing things. I mean, I just had to just touch Loretta Pitway. I had to touch her. I had to see her with my own eyes, with my own skin. An amazing woman, one of the great, 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 great artists of G's Bend, one of the top ones. And so other artists are always helping me to understand something about myself and something about the possibility and something about the directions that one can take. I was just with David Hammond the other day, always fascinating, always teaching me something else about the possibilities, these ideas about, you know, who is illuminating the path for you, who is walking on the same path along with you, even when I don't really understand the work or sometimes even like it. You know, but I'm always looking and trying to learn something. And one of the things that, you know, that I've really come to is that it really doesn't matter if I, quote, like it or not. What matters is that I understand the effort that goes into the making. The effort is extraordinary. Even when it's a failure, it's extraordinary, no? Right? Even when it's a failure. These ideas about, you know, encoding the skin and marking the skin, I think has been really important for any number of artists and certainly for myself. And Mark Scala, I was looking at Made in the Flesh, painted for the flesh, made in the flesh, paint made flesh, right? You know, this idea of marking this body, and the way in which artists have put themselves on display. And at a certain point, I realized that I was also putting myself on display and that I came out of a very deep tradition of artists behaving in a certain way, acting in a certain way, acting out in a certain way. You know, whether it be like James Luna, who puts himself before you, or someone like Eleanor Anton, who decides to be the black ballerina. Somebody was asking me recently about, you know, my sort of interest in storytelling. And, you know, indeed, you know, I was as informed by my father as I was by people like Eleanor Anton and David Anton, who were, you know, extraordinary storytellers, extraordinary people who dealt with text. And I encountered them as a graduate student at when I was at UCSD. They were very important and formative to me, you know, going beyond this idea of sort of the sort of Afro-American tradition, maybe, and really getting into sort of deeper territory of what it means to use language and work. An idea that sometimes you can't absolutely, you know, use, you know, that you can use language as a way, as a kind of a marker. Then there are moments when, like, that language collapses. And, you know, somebody like, I think, you know, both Adrian Piper, that idea that Adrian did these sort of wonderful works where she would paint herself black, and then she would walk down the streets and sort of try to brush up against people. You know, there are moments when, like, there are no words. The only thing that you are left with, really, is the action, right? And that you can't put it into words, that, you know, there are no words that can contain what it is that you are really trying to do, right? You know, the words simply serve, you know, as a description, trying to get close to maybe an understanding of some sort of truth about what it is that somebody believes that they saw about what you were trying to do. And then there are people, you know, these great people, these great women like Anna Mandiata, who I think is so amazing, just so amazing. You know, and the thing that I realized is that, you know, ultimately I would start coming back to these people again and again and again and again and again in the work. I show them all the time because I'm still dealing and negotiating with who they are and what they mean to me as an artist. You know, this sort of work by Felix Gonzalez Torres. And so powerful. This, you know, as his body is changing, as he's attempting to negotiate AIDS and what it's doing to him, right? What it's doing to him and a whole community of people. He makes these absolutely gorgeous, 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 gorgeous beads that one has to pass through. I think it's absolutely amazing, really fabulous, and I wish I'd made that work. You know, I mean, that's really sort of a fabulous thing when you look at, like, other artists and you say, damn, why didn't I think of that? I should have made that. So then I do all these other kinds of projects, too. You know, so a few years ago, I started a group. It's called Social Studies 101. And we've done various projects over the years. One of our first major projects was done with Edenville, the Zora Neale Hurston Museum in Edenville, Florida. My husband worked on the project along with me, and Deb Willis worked on the project along with me, who made really wonderful photographs, and Franklin Sermon wrote the catalog essay. So we've been actually stomping in the same territory, the same ground, same love and support for a very, very long time. But social studies has gone on to do other kinds of things, and one of the things that social studies does is it sort of operates as a kind of umbrella for any number of things. And so you know, one of the things that I become very interested in was these sort of acts of performance, and this character, this clown that I had developed, started taking me into the world in a really interesting way. I've been really interested in circus and clown for many, many years. I don't even remember when I became interested. It's been going on for a while. And but I took her out in public for the first time, you know, as the ruler of the world. And this character, I would take her to various places. She would ride up and down the subways in New York with signs like, you know, reading "One Man's Vote." One man's vote is like the Joker's joke, or selling hopes and dreams in a bottle for $19.99. And I like trying to sell things for $19.99. I tried to sell photographs for $19.99, but nobody would buy them from me for $19.99. So I had to put, like, you know, then I put $199. Nobody would buy them at $199. So then I put, like, you know, $1,099. And then I started selling, like, a few. And then I put, you know, $19,099. And then I sold, like, even a lot more, right? You know what I mean? I mean, but I could not sell the same photograph for $19.99. I think it's really an interesting idea about the commodification, the idea about the sort of assumed values. Very funny. A sense of place has been really important for me, trying to understand a sense of place. And I go to a lot of places very quietly photographing the landscape of those places. And that has taken me and led me into very deep territories over the course of my life. This is, of course, Memphis. I had to sort of stand there at the site of the Lorraine Hotel to understand that place in a very particular moment in time that, of course, haunts not only my imagination, but the American imagination. We all know what happened at the Lorraine Hotel, and if you don't, then you should. To Portland, Oregon, to the place that I live contemporarily, where I'm working on a project around ideas about community through social studies, but through this group that I've also been working on, or a project that I've been working on called Project Activate, which has to do with looking at violence in one particular community and how to respond to that. I'd started with this idea about the various kinds of classes one could be taking, looking at the relationship between art and civic dialogue, involving some of my students in that process of art and civic dialogue, and then, of course, working on our own project, having people like Peter Sellers come talk to us about the possibilities, and then starting a new project just this past summer, thinking about Project Activate, thinking about the way in which we were responding to the community, and then finally coming up with this idea that perhaps one of the ways to deal most effectively would be to offer young people jobs. And so that's what we did. We offered them jobs within the sphere of culture, introducing them to fashion and style. It's called the Institute of Sound and Style. But before we got to the Institute of Song and Style, we actually had this project of putting up lawn signs right after a child had been killed in the neighborhood. And many, many people came out of their houses, or not many, many people, but people came out of their houses in order to help put up those signs that I made one afternoon, had printed. So I was doing billboards, I was doing matchbook covers, I was doing posters, I was doing flyers, a safe zone. I was just sort of activating the space around me, the neighborhood around me, and trying to figure out sort of very ingenious ways to use the media in order to, like, sort of get this material out. How do you use billboards? How do you use matchbooks? How do you use the newspaper? How do you put an insert in the newspaper so that you could circulate it around to any number of communities, a number of households, right, by the thousands, because I couldn't hand deliver them all, right? You know, so we came up with all these sort of various strategies for getting the work out into the world, and then finally we decided that we wanted to talk about deterrence, and we came up with this project, the Institute of Sound and Style, which was an absolute blast. We started with 23 kids, and we ended with 23 kids. We paid them all because we knew that they were poor kids who needed money, and if they didn't have money, they were going to try to figure out another way of getting it. So when we talk about, you know, sort of like, you know, what's going on in communities, I think that first and foremost, we have to start thinking about economic collapse. These communities are collapsing. There's no money in those communities. So no amount of sort of cultural development is going to do any good if the community doesn't have any money. You know, it's ridiculous. So that was the place that we started. That was the place that we started in, and then made this little piece in a relationship, of course, to Trayvon Martin. So for me, that was very important to make this sort of connection. And of course, Hank Willis Thomas is doing really wonderful work around black men. His really amazing project on black men, I think, is very important and really predates this work, but is important to what happened with Trayvon Martin and what happens, continues to happen with African American men around the country. I heard someplace last night that over the course of the year in New York City, 700,000 black and Latino men are stopped, and it leads to the arrest of about 10%. That's like shocking, right? And so, you know, that, you know, Trayvon Martin, you know, is really not an anomaly. The thing that's, you know, abnormal about him is that, you know, his mother and father had voice. They had voice, you know, not unlike the young man, what was his name? Scott, in the 1920s, 1930s. Who were we talking about? I can't remember. Who was the young man who was killed? I can't think of his name right now, I'm sorry. But his mother also had voice, so that we learned something about, we learned something about him, and you have to forgive me for slipping his name right now. So this was a wonderful small project to work on, and you know, and I keep going back to these ideas about voice over and over and over, and then started making these images of people who were losing voice, whose voices were fading, whose voices were somehow dying, whose voices that we weren't quite hearing in the same register anymore. At a certain point, stumbled upon thinking about these women who were also losing voice, who had been so enormously important to the shape and the contours of the American imagination, who gave us amazing sound to live by and to love by and to cry by and to dance by. You know, that they were these very, 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 and maintain, for me, a very important status, and yet they seemed to be fading away, that the only time I heard them was when I actually dug really into my own collection of material, into my own archive, and that's when they sort of came back alive to me and for me. And so I thought that it might be important to just spend a little bit of time looking at them and thinking about them and offering them up for consideration. Mahalia. Coco Taylor. Diana Washington. Abby Lincoln. And smoke for Lorna. In the last year, I've worked a bit with musicians. I've always had a deep love for music, and it's informed a lot of my life. So we presented Slow Fade to Black as a part of the Celebrate Brooklyn this year, along with Jerry Allen, Patrice Rushen, Esperanza Spalding, Maurice Chestnut, the amazing tap dancer, was with us, along with Howard's choir. It was really quite an evening of performance, and hopefully we'll get a chance to present it again. These essays on influence continue. Long ago, I started looking at Bergman, loving his films, and Wild Strawberries being one of my favorite. Setting up these systems of double reflection have been really important, and I've come back to the use of mirror again and again and again, these themes that keep cropping up in the work and making themselves felt in a new way have been pretty consistent, actually, in the work. Whether I'm dealing with this frame, this body as a source of the work, or others. thinking about ways of mediating material, I brought together the Persuasions with a group of opera singers last year to make really quite amazing sound. The Persuasions are a doo-wop group, but very much interested in these like this layering of material. You know, what you see on the screen, that first screen. What do you see then in deep space, and what is the relationship between that sort of sense of artifice that plays on the first surface and that deeper space that is also a photographic space that's also a level of artifice but appears to be in some weird way slightly more real. It's very interesting. It was a wonderful thing for me to play around with, and I continue to think about this. I continue to think about this form. And out of this actually was produced also a series of videos and a series of photographs, and we'll return maybe to some of it a little later. A tribute to, there are these, inside of them are these tributes to other artists, these tributes to other forms, these tributes to other scopes of imagination. Again, going back to Anna Mundiata, it was a very important piece for me to make. Or referencing Duchamp and his idea about the impossible. In these sort of hyper spaces, these dense mediated spaces, theatrical spaces, really wonderful to work on. This piece that Duchamp had done years ago that I think about often, it's the piece that I return to again and again and again at the Philadelphia Museum of Art to look at it, to think about it, to study it. One of the creepiest images that I know of, installations that I know of, but absolutely brilliant and deep and complicated. And I'm complicated, you know, and I'm troubled by them, even as I make my own spaces with them, even as I make my own photographs alluding to them. And so I'm going to come back to some of this material just a little later in the talk when I show you actually a video piece that I actually made based on some of this work that I just shot in the last year or so. And then, of course, there are, you know, these sort of pieces like, you know, Kitchen Table, which was a very important piece for me to make. I made it, you know, when I was living in Northampton. A lot of things were going on, a lot of fascinating discussions were happening within the academy, around the issues of making, and realizing that there had been very little space really carved out really for women who look like me. And so it occurred to me at a certain point that it was really important for me to make images of women who reflected something that I wanted to see in the world, that I make images of what I really needed to see in the world, that it was my responsibility to make images of what I wanted to see in the world. There was nobody else's responsibility, that I could critique what wasn't there all day long, right? But ultimately, at the end of the day, what do you want to see? And then how do you make it? What do you want to see and how do you make it for those students? What do you want to see and how do you make it? What are you committed to? What drives you? What motivates you? Or for you older artists as well, right? What do you want to see? And then your role then becomes that. You know, mine was, I want to see something that's born out in a very particular way, at a very particular moment, that reflects something that I need to see that I'm not seeing. But also, I'm going to do that using this form, this very particular form of photography. I'm interested in documentary, but it's not a document, right? It is really, you know, much more than that. But it alludes to documentary, and so that play became really important. And I've been in that space of play. I've been in this place of the space of play for a very long time. I think I see myself really, sort of dancing in the margin, and that there is actually a great comfort in being in the margin. That it's a really wonderful place to work. Right, that it has sort of amazing energy, that it's not in the mainstream. I have no idea what it means to be in the mainstream. I don't want to be in the mainstream. I want to be pretty much where I am, dealing with these very tough issues, because that's the space that you can actually do them in. I don't want to paint flowers. you know? even as I love them, and sometimes I make photographs of them too. So dupes by one another, yet bound by certain social conventions, you framed me and I framed you, but we were both framed by modernism. And even though we knew better, we continued that time-honored tradition of the artist and his model. These ideas about being an accomplice in one's own victimization, I think, is really important. Standing on shaky ground, I posed myself for critical study, but was no longer certain of the questions to be asked. It was clear I was not Monet's type, and Picasso, who had a way with women, only used me, and Duchamp never even considered me. But it could have been worse. Imagine my fate had de Kooning gotten hold of me. You know, this sort of ongoing idea about unrequited love is a very important part of my work. And I only came to realize that a few years ago, but it's very consistent, you know, and I can see it often in much of the work. Italian Dreams is also very much about unrequited love. From here, I saw what happened and I cried, trying to bring together these complicated histories, both of the history of photography on the one hand, the history of blacks in photography on the other, or at least the history of the representation of blacks through American photography. So sort of bringing up these sort of two histories that are rubbing, you know, or multiple histories that are rubbing up against one another, creating a certain kind of friction, a certain kind of tension. I did this as a part of a commission for the Getty in 1996, I think it was. And I'll read some of it to you. You became a scientific profile, a Negroid type, an anthropological debate, and a photographic subject. You became mammy, mama, mother, and then confidant. Ha. Descending the throne, you became foot soldier and cook. You became house, yard, field, and kitchen. You became Uncle John, Tom, John and Clemens, Jim. Drivers, writers and men of letters. For your names you took Hope and Humble. Black and tan, your whipped wind of change howled low, blowing itself smack in the middle of Ellington's orchestra. Billy heard it too and cried, strange fruit, tears. Born with a veil, you became root worker, juju mama, voodoo queen, hoodoo doctor. Some said you were the spitting image of evil. You became playmate to the patriarch and its daughter. You became an accomplice. And the music score for God Bless the Child. You became the Joker's joke and anything but what you were. Ha. Some laughed long and hard and loud. And others said, well, the only thing a nigga can do for me is to shine my shoes. You became boots and spades and coons. And restless after the longest winter, you marched and marched and marched. And in your sing-song prayer, you asked, well, didn't my Lord deliver Daniel? A piece from Ritual and Revolution. At a certain moment, I made these three bodies of work. They're all printed on cloth. They all have text to them. They all have audio with them. And for the most part, I actually worked with other musicians. James Newton did the score for the Jefferson Suite. I did the bells for Ritual and Revolution, which is here. And somebody else did the text for and the music for the Hampton Project, but I don't remember off the top. You have to forgive me. But there was a wonderful way of working. It was allowed me to get off the wall, and I had been interested in getting off the wall for a while and activating space in a different kind of way, that I needed a different kind of relationship in a different kind of scale, and that I wanted people to move through the work, to pass through the work, that I wanted them to brush up against things. And so, and that happened. It happened that you could be inside and outside of something simultaneously, that you could be in the work, that you were part of it, right? That you were it, right? And that you were inside this history simultaneously, this thing that wraps around you. At least that was sort of like the idea of working on them. I don't know if that really happens or not, but it was certainly the idea of what I was trying to get at. And working on them also sort of allowed for this way of you know, this way that I'm starting to become more and more interested in, and the way in which a text and an idea and a concept and is delivered, not only to my audience, but for me, for first and foremost. How do I want to experience living through a work, living through a certain kind of experience? This is from the Hampton Project, and so you have a sense, again, this piece is Ritual and Revolution is here, but you have a sense of the way in which these were hung in other institutions. The Hampton Project dealing, of course, I'm always dealing with lots of different issues in the work. There's never one position that I'm really trying to outline. I'm usually dealing with sort of multiple terrains in a work, and the Hampton Project was certainly as complicated as any of them that I'd ever worked on. What was the relationship of blacks and Native Americans to one another, and ideas around education, ideas around their practice, you know, the relationship of institution to an institution, what was, you know, the relationship of Williams College to Hampton, and Hampton's relationship to the Smithsonian, and I mean, there were all of these sort of complicated factors that were really being teased out in this work, you know, in these sort of simple forms of before and after. And this image, this pair of images sort of set up a very, very sort of difficult debate that I was to go on to have, actually, with Hampton, because Hampton, at a certain moment after the show, it traveled many, many, many places, and Aperture did a really beautiful book, Hampton decided that they weren't going to take the exhibition because, for the most part, they really didn't want to deal with the issue of the internment of Native Americans that are still buried at the university. And so it was really sort of an unfortunate development, but they never took the show, so it never actually got there at all, though I think that it was a really important critical piece. And of course I've been interested, you know, like in ideas of, you know, material culture for a very long time, and that's where actually Katie started her work on the Sea Island series that I did. These ideas about looking at, you know, sort of forms of looking at, you know, architecture, looking at, you know, the architectures of things, things really sort of interests me, intrigues me, and I come back to it again and again and again, and it plays out again, you know, like in a place like, you know, in the Africa series, in a piece like the Africa series. And again, this piece is on display here as well. You know, being fascinated with architecture and the meaning of architecture and the way in which certain cultures use architecture in order to speak profoundly about who belongs in a space. So beautifully, beautifully articulated, I think, in these photographs. It sort of reminds me of an Irving Penn, except that, you know, except that it's really a building in Mali, as is this one, right? So these ideas about who belongs to the space, right? Female space and male space is very clearly inscribed on the architecture itself. And so those ideas have been very important to me. Grabbing, snatching, bleak, and you be gone. One of my favorite photographs of, you know, the Portuguese and their architecture, the architecture of slavery, it exists along the west coast of Africa, in Ghana. Really sort of an amazing, beautiful photograph, and it's here, and I hope that some of you will get a chance to look at it. Being in these sort of areas of contested territory is the space, I guess, that I'm often in, and maybe I'm that black stripe, you know, there. You know, between those two worlds. I am someplace located in the middle. This is in Israel, looking at what's going on there, looking at Gettysburg, what's going on there. I'm deeply curious about these spaces, looking at architecture, looking at landscape, because I think it informs us so much about who we are, what we think about ourselves and what we do in the world. How to organize that, I think then, is probably the thing that I am the most interested in. How do I organize the material? How do I handle the material? How do I live with the material and make it into something more than perhaps it may have been meant to be? If you can add a level of criticality and investment and questioning to the work, then for me, I think it's come to another place of consideration and possibility. Maybe then we can actually have a conversation if there is just a bit of criticality involved in the work that we are looking at. From Cuba to Louisiana, using myself often, not because I'm really fascinated with the way that I look, but because I'm usually up at 2 o'clock in the morning. Using masks, and there, you know, there's so much material, there's so much to tell you about. You know, there's so many ideas that are a part of a piece like the Louisiana series or the Cuba series. I mean, they're very sort of deeply involved pieces. But I think that no matter what I'm doing, that I'm always trying to figure out, first and foremost, how to have a conversation with myself around materials and ideas that are deeply troubling for me, and things that keep me up at night and get me up in the morning. Where are we? What are we doing together? How do we negotiate and make it through this complicated maze of life that we are involved in? And this is the only question that I really have, and it's the thing that I come back to, I believe, again and again and again and again and again, but through a different door, through a slightly different angle. But asking the same question over and over and over. I remember long nights and endless discussions with you when we were not afraid to speak our minds. And now I only hear the hush, hush, hush of our mutual silence. And then asking questions like, where is the opposition and who is the opposition, and relying on earlier forms of making, relying on the constructivist, and thinking about semaphore and flagging, that it was sort of amazing that semaphore would happen in the Soviet Union, and they would use the international language of the sea in order to make a body of work, make a body of paintings, develop a whole tradition based on the language of semaphore, I believe. I think it's really amazing. And then, of course, that goes on to influence the hundreds and thousands of artists all over the world, and including me, my coming back to that material and using it and thinking about it. And you know, some of this work has like a very short life, like nobody really wants to see it. So, you know, so it goes back in my closet. And so if anybody's got 1999, I'll be in the back. You know, the Beacon Project, many things about the Beacon Project. Beacon was fascinating because Dia moved there. So I'm always dealing with these sort of curious things that are happening in communities. You know, Dia moved there. The Dia Foundation moved to Beacon, New York, about an hour away from New York City. And things started to happen in that city that had never happened before. You know, people that had lived in the city couldn't quite live in the city anymore because suddenly it was changing. It was becoming like this boutique town. And on the one hand, people were very excited about that, but at the same time, people were also being displaced. And so I put on the main street a record shop that was there for 3 years. And for 3 years, I would go to Beacon a lot and photograph it. I photographed like the main street over and over and over and over as it began to take on a different shape and a different character and a different quality and so forth. It was really sort of fascinating. And of course did an image and text piece that consists of maybe 30, 35, 40 photographs that really look at Beacon over a period of time. And the idea was that I would be there for 3 years in the record shop, and then 3 years later, someone like Tim Rollins would come to the record shop, and then they would take it for 3 years. And then Tim Rollins would invite the next person to come in, and they would take it for 3 years. So that was sort of like the plan, you know, because I realize now that you can't do, Katie, I think you'll agree, you really can't do anything in 3 years, right? It takes at least 3 years to get it together, right? You know, like you can't do it in like, you know, 3 months, you know, or 6 months. It's bullshit. You have to like take the time, and you have to be there, and you have to really work, and you have to think about it in advance, and then you have to plan how you want to do it. And for the most part, a lot of people are only really interested in sort of like the flash and the dash of the moment. They're really not interested in the serious work. The serious work really takes time. And that's why Obama, for instance, hasn't been able to get his shit together, because it takes time. You know what I mean? You know, you cannot have a collapsed economy and have it come back the next week because you're voted in. So, you know, so that was a place like, you know, like Beacon, and it was really wonderful being there. And then I got, you know, amazingly, I was invited to do like this residency in Rome. Now, I had wanted to go to Rome like all my life. Remember Gidget Goes to Rome, you know? I mean, like, I wanted to be Gidget. I wanted to be like there with like three coins in the fountain, the whole thing. You know, I wanted to be like Annette Funicello. You know, what was in there? You know, like, I wanted all that. But I didn't go to Rome until I was much older. And I'm so happy, because I wouldn't have known what to do with it. You know, I wouldn't have known what to do with Rome at 16. I probably would have had lots of wild and crazy sex, which would not have been bad. But I went later when I was married to my very hot husband. So it worked out. And so, you know, so it was very interesting. You know, there's this idea that, you know, I'm only supposed to be in certain places. And the thing that I really learned about being in a place like Rome, like they were like, you know, I bumped into like hundreds of people, not hundreds, but dozens of people that I knew in Rome. I mean, I met all, it's like, what are you doing here? And they would say to me, what are you doing here? What are you doing here? Now, this was actually very interesting. What, Carrie Mae Weems, are you doing in Rome? And, because this isn't your territory. And that was very interesting. It was actually very interesting because it got down to, you know, Rome is for other people who like other kinds of things. So what are you doing here? And it was really kind of fascinating because it was really a group of people trying to put me in a box. You know, that as a black artist, maybe I could be in the South or I could be in some place, but my ass was not supposed to be running up and down, you know, the streets of Rome on a regular basis. And yet, the thing that was so sort of amazing out of many, many of the artists that have really been there, I'm probably the one that took most advantage of being in the city. And, you know, I've been very interested in sort of structures of power. And so Rome is the first sort of major power in the world. Was absolutely essential. You know, that the relationship between Rome and Africa is much more dynamic in some ways than the relationship between Rome and New York. You know what I mean? I mean, it's really sort of fascinating once you start to sort of peel back all those layers. It's much easier for me to get, you know, to Africa from Rome than it is for me to get to New York City, you know, or to Portland, Oregon. So there's this sort of way, I think, in which we're sort of thought of, this way in which black artists are thought of, and we're sort of confined and contained into social spaces that really delimit our possibility, and I simply refuse to allow that to destroy me, even as I can feel the pressure of it. I refuse to allow it to destroy me, and that using my imagination and using my will and using my strength and using my power to challenge those notions, I think is really essential to what I do, and it's essential to the way I hope that I live my life and the work that I'm attempting to make. This is the great city of Matera. I absolutely love this rising up and falling down of this city. I eat this photograph. I eat this picture. And so I moved around a great deal throughout various spaces of not only the city of Rome, but moving around the country of Italy itself and going, of course, to the great city of Matera, walking the streets of Rome. And I would get up very, very, very early in the morning, because the only way that you can really photograph in a very busy city like Rome is to get your ass up and to get out very early and to make these pictures. And, you know, this way of this position of the figure in relation to the thing was really important to me. How this character leads you through a discourse with that city, negotiating the power of the state and through the church, which is of course the city itself. The only pyramid in Rome, fabulous. San Lorenzo, the most contested part of the city, the working class part of the city, the most vocal part of the city, the only part of the city that was bombed during the war. And next to the Aurelian Wall, which I walked the entire circumference of, and standing at each of those 13 gates as an entry into and out of the city. The fascist Rome, not only, you know, sort of, you know, Renaissance Rome, and, you know, romantic Rome, and the churches of Rome, but also fascist Rome. Mussolini's Rome was really interesting to me, and I spent a lot of time in this section of the city, and really, I think I have probably 100 pretty serious photographs from this series. And fortunately, Yale is really interested in doing its book on Rome and on this series. And so we're really looking forward to that coming out in the next year. I'm really excited about the possibility of really looking at the way in which this city is divided and the way in which it considers itself. And just as I was finishing up this project on Rome, I made some photographs, at the museum there, which set me off like on a whole new course and a whole new thinking about space. You know, that not only did I want to, you know, stand in front of, you know, like the church, you know, but I also wanted to stand in front of these primary institutions, these cultural institutions. And so this was actually the first photograph that I made, the last photograph that I made in Rome. that sort of set me up for making like another body of work that has taken me like several years. So it's really sort of fascinating, you know, like the work really tells you what it wants, it tells you what it wants to be and how it wants to be, what it is, and paying attention to it becomes really important. It tells me a great deal more about myself than I would ever know otherwise, what my interests are. And so I moved to these various spaces, these various institutions, these various museums around the world, really thinking about the role of museum. My girlfriend said to me one day, she said, when are you going to turn around? And I thought, you know what? No, nobody wants to see this face. Nobody wants to see this. And it's not about my face anymore. It's really about where this body is, and it can be located, and what she can do along with you as the viewer to begin to consider and to imagine new spaces of habitation, to question the role of these institutions. That is her role. And so I continue to do this work. It's an ongoing body of work. And if I'm not too exhausted, normally when I'm traveling, I try to bring my camera and bring my clothes with me so that I can actually make photographs of the museums that are in that city. It occurred to me at a certain point that, you know, really nobody was really interested in me, and nobody really wanted to see me. And this is, I think, sort of like an important idea, that nobody really wanted to see me, you know, as a sort of a metaphor. And so how to sort of deal with this idea became really important. How to sort of offset this ongoing question of color and race and start thinking about it as sort of a deeper and more complex way became really resulted in this woman whose back is always to the audience from colored people, which is also here. The Africa series, which we don't have time to talk about. But they are like these like little morsels that can be consumed. I think of them as being absolutely beautiful. So all these strategies for looking and consuming complex layers of blackness is really what I'm thinking about, and complex layers of humanity. Can you consume it? Will you take it? Will you take it into yourself? Take it into your heart and your mind? Can you use it? Can we push beyond sort of the narrow constraints that surround us into more open territory for spaces of consideration and imagination? I hope so. The number of film projects that I have done, some of them, many of them, are here, from Coming Up for Air and Mayday's Long Forgotten, Meaning and Landscape, A Woman's Journey, In Love and in Trouble, and Out of Time. Unfortunately, Make Somebody Happy is not here. It's so hilarious. In Italian Dreams. From still images from those series, from Italian Dreams, where I was able to work in Fellini's old studio in Rome, which was really a great, 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 great honor, channeling that man, you know? And every day I would drive to the studio in Cinecittà, and I would say, ciao, you know? And they'd like, you know, say, Brooklyn. They were so excited that I was there. And, you know, I'd swing past everybody in my little car and sort of wave. It was so cute. I loved every minute of it. Making the work was complicated, and making the work was tough. It was really hard. And the work, in a lot of ways, I think, you know, as light as I can be about certain things, the work is actually extraordinarily painful. It's really hard stuff. It always is dealing with really complicated, tumultuous issues that I simply have not been able to resolve, and that really do keep me up, keep me motivated, keep me going at it yet again. And then at a certain point, I made this little piece. It's called Constructing History. where I constructed a classroom, you know, being involved in theater in one way or another has been a long-held interest. And working in video, working in film, building these sets have been really important for me. I love the physicality of it, even though it's really exhausting and draining. In constructing these spaces where I can, these constructing very simple spaces where I can actually play out a series of ideas has been very important to me. Re-examining photographs that have been made, re-examining histories that have already been told, but I need to put my stamp on them. I need to say something about them. I needed to say something about the 60s. I needed to say something about the level of tragedy that really shaped and formulated who we are contemporarily, right? That we would be nothing really without, you know, the assassination of Kennedy. We would be nothing without the assassination of King. Yeah? We would be nothing without the assassination of Malcolm. That their lives actually made us possible. That their lives actually made us possible, that their deaths also made us possible, I think, is really, really important to get to. And so, you know, so I needed to understand that, and I wanted my students to understand it along with me, and so I created this space that we could live and work in for a period of time, and I asked them to find out everything they could about that day, that situation, that event, that assassination, that moment, where it happened, who it happened to, who was there, who was around it, right? You know, what time did it happen? You know, just asking my students to be very, very careful in understanding something about that day, that place in history, and then reenacting that so that we could, like, look at it and talk about it and think about it, and then I could make a film about it and a series of photographs around it. And it was absolutely really a wonderful piece to work on, and some of these photographs, most of these photographs, and the film Constructing History, A Requiem to Mark the Moment, are here, so I won't really talk very much more about them. But making these spaces is kind of wonderful. And there's all this sort of, I'm very influenced by a number of different things, you know, whether it's on the one hand Bergman sort of, bright, crisp, harsh reality, or that sort of Brechtian thing, you know, that kind of light. But I'm sort of situated someplace in between, you know, because the way in which Americans sort of process light and the way in which, you know, Europeans process light, they're very different things, you know, and these are really physical things that have real physical, you know, implication and material implication, finally. And then finally, this is the last piece that I'm going to talk about. And I'm hoping that I'll show you just a little bit of film around it if we have enough time. I'll check with Katie in a few minutes to see. This is a project that I actually just finished. It's at the Mattress Factory right now. And it's sort of like a series of holograms. And again, I built a theater in a small chamber. And wanted to have a series of conversations again with myself and a conversation around ideas about history and about women and about the role of women in space as well. So I did sort of both those things, and I think I'm going to show you a bit of it if it's okay. This is, you know, Abe Lincoln. I brought in an Abe Lincoln impersonator, was really quite wonderful, who recited some of the Gettysburg Address, and a tap dancer, which is, you know, the image that I really started with early on. And it's a story with, you know, Lonnie Graham, who talks about his experience with levels of discrimination. A group of men who are shouting at one another because they hate each other so much. My Joker then makes another appearance where she talks about levels of revenge, which is sort of fascinating to me. She's a very interesting character. I also brought in a boxer who keeps fighting and who just keeps duking it out, keeps punching it out no matter what. And these women, these young women figures that I also made photographs of as well, these ideas around women. a Playboy bunny who's like, you know, played out, who just can't get her outfit on. You know, and Francesca Woodman, a really sort of extraordinary dancer who I really, really enjoy watching very much. Katie, what time is it? Do we have time to see a few minutes of our film? Okay, then. So, we'll start. How are people feeling? Yeah, because we all just got here anyway, right? Okay. So it's not too bad. I think that we'll go ahead and we'll start, and we'll skip through some of it, but we'll start and we'll just see how far we want to go. Okay? Alrighty. So can we bring the house lights down, please, and we'll start the film.
Four score and 7 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now, we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation, or any nation so conceived, so dedicated, can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who gave their lives so that the nation might live. In a larger sense, we cannot dedicate We cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here have consecrated it far beyond our poor power to add or to detract. The world will know little nor long remember what we say here, what we say here, what we say here. But it will never forget, it will never forget, it will never forget what we did here. It is for us, the living, rather, to dedicate here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far, thus far, thus far, so nobly. It is rather for us to be here, dedicated to the task remaining before us, the task before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion, that we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, this nation, under God, shall have a new birth for freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, should not perish from this earth.
Thank you.
cut that now. And with that, I'll just say thank you.